approve the minutes.
Unanimous.
Support.
And move to support, any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, motion carries. Just a little housekeeping before we go to public comments. Under old business, the report on the control search, that's going to be done at the next government ops meeting. That will be done at the next government ops meeting. So at this time, it's set aside for public comments for committee. You will have 2 minutes to address the board. Public comments once, public comments twice, public comments are closed. We have no communications, we have no old business. Under new business, county bills.
Pay the bill.
Support.
Been moved and supported, any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, motion carries. B, burial claims.
Move it.
Support.
Been moved and supported, any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, motion carries. C, prosecutor office requests approval to accept auto theft fraud protection grant and enter into agreement for the service. It's attached and it's going to be a roll call vote. It's been moved.
Support.
And supported, any discussion? Commissioner Henry.
I just wouldn't feel right if Mr. Popper didn't get to come on. It's the same as we've had, John?
Yeah, same grant and same program we've had for, what, 29 years or so? With the same arrangement in terms of having two assistant prosecutors, or four assistant prosecutors dividing their time about 25% each, and two clerical workers that make up a part-time position. We're the only county in the state that has this arrangement. For many years, this county had one dedicated assistant prosecutor and one dedicated part-time secretary. But we've had this arrangement with agreement from the state of Michigan for 4 or 5 years now, which gives us flexibility in the office to have four assistants giving their time to auto theft and fraud and insurance fraud cases, but also being able to do general casework at the same time.
Yeah, do you have any cases where are you in the county?
I think I have the information in the grant application.
That's okay, I will.
But I could get back to you on that. I can't tell you precisely how many offhand. I probably should have been prepared with that.
Well, you know, sometimes Spartans get away with that.
Right.
Commissioner Adams.
So I'm familiar with the activities of the office. Would that include something like someone who would get the victim of a scheme where they, somebody called and told they won the lotto and then they kept giving them money? Is that the office that would prosecute that kind of stuff?
No, this is a subdivision of the Michigan State Police. It's a specific entity created by statute that deals only with auto theft and auto fraud, auto insurance fraud cases, but nothing to do with somebody, other types of fraud that might be taking place.
Could you describe a typical auto fraud case?
Well, the typical case is where somebody leaves their keys in the car, the door's unlocked, and the car gets stolen. That would be an auto theft case. And
that's a theft.
For auto insurance fraud, where somebody maybe makes arrangements to have their car stolen and then they make a claim. What's that?
Do you get many of those? Or is it mostly theft?
It's mostly theft. It's a whole variety of different cases. We also include carjackings in that. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, carjacking is not necessarily being used to steal a car, but it's being used as a getaway car for drug trafficking and things like that. But we include that. We have a whole laundry list of different crimes that fall under the umbrella.
Okay, thank you.
Any more questions, Commissioner Clark?
I think some months ago, Mr. Prosecutor, I asked for a report and update on the types of crimes. It's been some time ago, but I'm still interested in that. If we could have a report before the new year, I'd like, and I didn't ask this, I do remember, I didn't ask for locations, where are the most crimes taking place in terms of our districts and the types of crimes. I know that our county is, they're not void of car thefts also, so I really would like to know where they're taking place, the majority are taking place, not the majority, just where they're taking place. And if you could share that with us before we go into a new year, I would really appreciate that.
Absolutely. And I believe I did respond to you last time with your question.
I want you to come before us.
What's that?
I wanted you to come before us.
Okay.
With those stats,
okay,
though.
I will do that, yes.
Okay. Something else, too. Would you have the data on teenagers who do this kind of crime?
That might be more difficult to come by.
Okay.
That would take a lot of work on a case by case to look at the age.
Don't do that. Just give me the data where they most occur.
I would appreciate that. I can do that, sure.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
More discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Norman?
Yes.
Platt?
Present. Yes.
Curtis?
Yes.
Young?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Lynn?
Yes.
Henry?
Yes.
Adams?
Yes.
D, Prosecutor's Office requests approval for the Crime Victims' Right Grant FY2017.
Support.
Been moved and supported. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you, Commissioners.
E, Office of Sheriff requests approval for overnight travel for two paramedics to attend the Medical Control Authorities Conference and Michigan Trauma Conference 2016. Building for the Future for the period of October 2nd through 4th, 2016 at the Grand Traverse Resort at the cost not to exceed $398.
Support.
Been moved and supported. Any discussion? Commissioner Adams.
I might add, I probably should have stood up here. It's unfair for Mr. Potberry to answer questions. The sheriff runs game. And I'll work with Mr. Potberry and the prosecutor's office to get the stats that you wanted, teens and where those carjackings and all of this are being taken. So I should have jumped up a little bit sooner. But what question do you have, ma'am?
My question is, what is your plan for the two go to share with just the therapists?
Right. Great question. You'll see that this is rare that we ask for any overnight travel, but through the whole office. This is in partnership with the Medical Control Authority for updates in the legalities of emergency medicine for EMS. The two that we're sending are both in leadership, a sergeant and a lieutenant, and they come back and we filter that material that they learned, all 28, via roll call, text com, emails, and one-on-one counseling and coaching. So I am not, neither is the sheriff, a huge fan at all of sending people to travel for the sake of a vacation, and we hold them accountable to that.
Well, I'm confident that's the case, but since that's a golden opportunity to share information, I just want to make sure you have a plan for sharing.
Absolutely.
You know, sometimes people will go to a conference and they're the better for it, but
correct,
it doesn't get shared with other people who need that information, so I just want to check on that.
Right, correct. Yes, ma'am.
Any more discussion? Seeing on the roll call, please.
What?
Yes.
Curtis?
Yes.
Young?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Lynn?
Yes.
Henry?
Yes.
Adams?
Yes.
Nolens? Yes. Motion carries. F, Community Correction requests approval for the Michigan Free Prisoner Reentry FY2017 subcontract.
Move it.
Support.
Been moved and supported. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. G, Community Correction requests approval of PA 511 FY2017 funding.
Move it.
Support.
Been moved and supported. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. H, Human Resource requests approval for discrimination harassment policy procedure that's attached.
Move it.
It's been moved and supported. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. I, Human Resource requests approval for the Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan modification to retirees plan.
Move it.
It's been moved.
Support.
And support. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Retirement Commission requests approval for the 2015 annual report to the Genesee County Employees Retirement System.
Did you close your J?
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, you're right. Human Resource requests approval for the Equivax ACA service contract.
Move it.
Been moved.
Support.
And supported. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, motion carried. Now, K. Retirement Commission requests approval for the 2015 annual report to the Genesee County Employees Retirement System.
Move it.
It's been moved and support. Any discussion? Commissioner Hamrick.
Assume it's fine, I sit on the retirement.
Yes, I sit on the retirement commission, and that's why I waited to see if somebody else would move it, so.
Well, I wanted to have your approval.
Yeah. There's no problems.
Any more discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, motion carries. Controller, request approval for October 2016 overtime request in the amount of $37,530.
Move it.
Support.
Been moved and supported, any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, motion carries. Any other business? I just want to just say, this past Friday, at my, the other thing that I do, Burston Fieldhouse, we actually ended up building a playground. We had over 180 volunteers, and a few of the trade folks came out and helped. And I know Ellen Mellenberg, she came out and she saw the finished product. But it's going to be a great play space for the kids in the city of Flint. I just want to say thank you to all those that volunteered and came out. If you get a chance, 3300 North Saginaw Street, drive by, look at it. It's a beautiful playground with a lot of vivid colors. So with that, yes.
Do you have any winter activities for kids?
At Burston?
Yeah.
Oh my God, yes. We have dance, basketball, boxing.
No, outside.
Well, we have a hill there that they can use their sleds. So, yeah, we do have.
Do they keep it prepared?
We're gonna try to work on that. That's another thing. So that's something that I might be able to talk to you about, because I know you're in the construction field.
The outside skating.
Outside skating would be nice too.
About snow.
Yes. All right, with that, yes, yes, ma'am.
One comment, and I think this is the appropriate committee. I wanted to thank building and maintenance. Ray, did I see Ray? Just wait for him, Ray. I want to thank Ray and his team for making our building a pleasant place to come to in the morning. You know, a couple of years ago, I asked for cheap flowers, just something to make it a little more aesthetic. And they've done that, and they seem to have a lot of pride. So thank you, Ray, for making this a pleasant place to enter in the morning.
Okay, you're welcome. Any more discussion? Seeing none, I need a motion for adjournment.
Support.
Been supported. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed, for adjournment.
Call this public works meeting to order. Roll call, please.
Nolan. Nolan.
You're present.
Platt.
Present.
Curtis.
Here.
Northrup. Young.
Here.
Brown.
Here.
Lynch.
Here.
Henry.
Here.
Adams.
Here.
Need to move minutes?
Move them.
They're moved.
Support.
Supported. All in favor, signify by aye.
Aye.
Nays the same. Minutes pass. This time we have time set aside for public comment. You have 3 minutes. Please stand up, state your name, address. You have 3 minutes.
Bobby Walton, 8412 Maple View Drive, Davison, Michigan. I represent the Citizens Against Government Overreach. I'm here today to talk to you about two of the items on your agenda, both of which deal with public information and opportunities for the public to have input on some major decisions that are being made by this Board of Commissioners. One of the things that occurred in the primary election in August was, I think there was an outcry from the voters on the lack of public information and transparency by this Board of Commissioners. The very act that you put forth last year, I think it was, or earlier this year, to abolish the Senior Citizens Committee, to abolish the Animal Control Advisory Committee, and now you are going about selling another piece of government property without adequate public notice or public input or even any kind of discussion of the impact to the public of making this decision. It seems to me that as representatives of the public, of the people that live in your districts, that you would take seriously the things that you're doing that impact on their daily lives. And there's certainly nothing more important than where they get their services from the Department of Public Health. So I think it would be appropriate for our chief health officer to have some kind of say-so in a public forum on exactly how this would impact on the people of the Genesee County District. We don't all live in Flint. We don't all want to live in Flint, even though Flint is certainly a great source of services for the people in this county. And we don't need every single agency or every single opportunity for people to get public services to only exist in Flint. And I'm further concerned about the sale of this property because of the lack of parking for the women who would come to get services for their children under the WIC program. I understand all of the federal programs require free public parking for people who are coming for services. And with the destruction of the McCree parking ramp, I wonder how that's even going to be possible. So I'd like to hear that addressed also. And thank you.
Any other public comment?
Morning. Ellen Ellenberg, Burton 2228 East Booter, Burton City Council, representing council and representing residents of City of Burton. I was surprised that those two pieces were on the agenda. I thought it would have been solved, that it was going to wait for more clarity. And I went down to the health department probably a month ago when it was going to be up for, possibly up for sale. And I talked to a few of the people that were there at the department to get services. Some of the services, you know, one lady came all the way from Clyde because she appreciates where the location is. I feel that as a representative of the City of Burton, we should have been notified that that piece of property was going to be put out for sale so that we could basically prepare our residents to be able to that utilize that business or that department. I just feel that we need to have some more information of why, because it's up running business. And when I went, there was quite a few people there, and they seemed very pleasant when I went in and talked to the people that were waiting to go to the doctor or see a physician or have their children there. My granddaughter goes there. She just started going there. She's very comfortable with the doctor. It's very close to her home because my daughter, you know, she basically doesn't have a lot of money, but she can afford to go there. It has a bus station right there. So I think for the area, it's a building that we need to consider and basically have some information of why we want to get rid of this and why we want to sell it. I know that Hamilton Clinic, you know, is right next door, and that service offers a lot of services that the health department doesn't have. Like, you know, they do go dental there. I'm very aware of that program too. We're very proud to have that service in the City of Burton and to basically help our residents in the county at the convenience of how to get there. So thank you for your time this morning.
Any other public comment?
Good morning, my name is Doreen Scanlon. I live at 6166 Sunny Avenue, Flushing, Michigan. I just wanted to speak on behalf of being a volunteer at Genesee County Animal Control. For those of you who don't know, last Thursday evening, they received the award for the most improved open intake shelter, 1,200 or more. So that was fantastic. And I give a lot of credit to Director Wallace and Deputy Director Kennedy, and of course, their staff and the volunteers. The other thing that I'd like to say, which is just great things are happening at Animal Control, I would love to see the momentum continue as far as the renovation plans go. Last week, I'm on the cat team, so I know cat team numbers, but last week we adopted out 21 cats, which is phenomenal for us. So I was joking, hoping maybe this week we'd only have 30 in adoption. I know that the dog team adopted out, I believe it was 25 or 32 at the Detroit Zoo Meet Your Best Friends event. So again, great things are happening at Animal Control. Hopefully you will continue to support efforts there. Thank you.
Good job.
Good morning, I'm Richard Angelo. I live at 10271 Irish Road in Goodrich, Michigan. I wanted to echo the previous speaker's comments about animal control. This conference, the Michigan Pet Funds No-Kill Conference, has been held about 6 times in the last 10 years or so. And every year, some of us from Genesee County would go and hold our heads down and talk about the issues that we had. And this conference was so different because we had national leaders, we had state leaders in veterinary care, animal welfare and sheltering, and everybody, to a T across the board, was applauding the efforts of our county. And it was a great, great moment for our county shelter. Give a whole lot of credit to the staff, to the volunteers who bust their butt every day in that place, because they deserved all of the recognition that they got at this conference this year. It was leaders from across the country coming up and wanting to know, how did Genesee County do it? There was reference made to, over the last couple of years, based upon the numbers, approximately in the last 2 years, we've allowed about 5,000 more animals to leave that shelter on four legs as opposed to not. So I wanted to say thank you very much to this board for supporting the efforts and continuing to support them moving forward. Also, to echo what Doreen said, to follow up that great conference and to talk about how wonderful we did at Meet Your Best Friend at the zoo and at the shelter over the weekend, there were more than 40 animals adopted. So I want to keep it going, and I feel I would be remiss if I didn't come up here and applaud this board for the efforts in supporting that animal control, the leaders, their staff, and volunteers over the past couple of years. So thank you very much.
Commissioner Lynch, they kind of stole a little bit of my board because I was going to have Paul and some of the staff actually come to our next board meeting, and I was going to, you know, talk a little bit about that because that was a great, great event. And I have a little video out where Paul did a speech, and the reception that he got was just remarkable. So we were looking to do that on Monday.
So we did pretty well even without the animal advisory?
Yeah, we did.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, we did. Thank you. Really, really.
I don't think there's a question time. I think this is a public comment.
Mark Belichick, 11442 Skyline Drive, Benton, Michigan. As health officer, we've been working collaboratively with CHMP, the consultant was hired by the county to look at the transition of health department services to downtown. We're now opposed to change that improves the services to county residents. What we are concerned about is the fact that there has not been any information with regards to the cost estimates of that change. Burton Clinic has approximately 30 clinic exam rooms and counseling rooms. Those don't exist at the current structure. Staff is concerned about a smooth transition because of the number of clients that we see at Burton. There were over 27,000 WIC visits, about 11,000 immunization visits, and 1,500 family planning visits. With nutrition such an important element in response to the lead crisis that occurred in Flint, we don't want to see a deterioration in WIC services to the people in this community and want to be assured that if the Burton building is sold, that there is a smooth transition for those services to another location.
Is there any public comment?
My name is Kay Dorr, 1364 Woodknoll Avenue, Flint. And as I sit here, I can't help but think there are so many people who are not in this room today. And the people who are not in this room are the people that you represent, the people that use the services at Burton. And I would think that you would want all the information you could possibly get before making such an important decision that's going to impact those people. I get it. When we come to budget, we want to do things as carefully as we can to keep the budget in line. But if we make that off the backs of people who are now going to have difficulty getting their children into WIC, difficulty getting immunizations or family plannings, it's going to come back to bite us even financially, aside from the human suffering that will result. So I would just urge you to please use all the information that you possibly can and understand it well before you make such an important decision.
Is there any other public comment? Any other public comment? Public comments closed. Communication. We have two presentations today. We have a presentation of CHMP Inc. first.
Good morning. I'm Greg Mason with CHMP Architects. Kevin Cook, my partner with CHMP. We were retained to do two studies regarding the first, the McCree parking structure, which Kevin will review in detail, and number two, to evaluate the consolidation of the Burton Clinic to the McCree Center. So we're going to go through those two presentations, and we'll be happy to answer questions along the way.
Good morning again. My name is Kevin Cook. I trust each of you have received the summary evaluation. So if you allow, I'll just briefly go through the details of it. The existing structure was built in 1965 for Montgomery Wards. It includes a surface lot and a three-level parking structure, the first level being a slab-on-grade, and then the three levels above are supported in concrete structure. The building is generally divided into two sides, two rectangles that form an L. The southerly side is dedicated for county employees and has 415 total spots, 312 within the structure and 103 on the surface. The northerly rectangle is for the public, or what we denote as transient, and that's 483 spaces for a total on-site of 898 spaces. We'd also like to note that level three of the structure provides public access to the second floor of the McCree building. We've evaluated parking records from June 2016, December of 2015, and then also July of 2015. Going back to July, that's when the state of Michigan was still a tenant, so we wanted an idea of what capacity they use. December appears to be a light month because the courts are generally down for long periods of time. So we believe that June is a typical average month throughout the year. From that information, we've projected a total need for parking at the current staffing levels. We estimate 180 county employees, 25 of additional secured parking for county vehicles. And then with the potential implementation of the help of the Burton City, of the City of Burton facility into the county building, that would be 59 department employees. And also we estimate throughout the day that would result in 170 public parking uses. We took that number, divided it through the day of 9 to 5, estimating that a typical visit would be 2 hours, and then we put a peaking factor on top of that. That would be 76 public parking spaces at any one time throughout the day. So the total required parking projection is 340 spaces, significantly less than the 898 that's on site now. We gave you four options. The first being complete demolition of the structure and creating one large public lot. That would be 312 spaces. The second option is again demolition, but dividing the lot to provide dedicated county parking. Structural engineer's analysis that this is a feasible option. We've not done that to date. and that would provide an additional life of 10 to 15 years. The fourth option is complete demolition and construction of a new parking structure, three floors, that would then still provide access to the second floor of the McCree building, along with the surface lot. That would be approximately 300 spaces. We've also provided a map of the existing options for parking outside of the McCree building. We'll summarize that on Exhibit A. I don't think I need to go through that in detail unless anyone has any questions.
So basically, to address some of the concerns that were spoken earlier, we also agree that third level access is important. The shortcoming of the surface lot is, number one, there would not be enough spaces to meet the 340 program demand. We'd be short about 30 to 40 spaces, and it would provide an inconvenience for visitors. For the second floor McCree, they would have to go around to the front of the building, pass through the courts, go up the elevator and escalator, which is an inconvenience compared to how they currently operate. The third option, though we feel has some merit, there's a big risk. There have been three reports done on the McCree building, and all the reports have been noting the severe deterioration of the ramp and that significant repairs would be necessary. Ideally, the fourth option is the best. The fourth option is a smaller replacement structure that provides roughly 500 parking spaces and provides the third floor access to the McCree, which will be even more critical should the Burton Clinic move into the second floor. The demand for young mothers with infants and the WIC program, it's even more important to have convenient parking. So, you know, we're encouraging option four. I know it's the most expensive. Option three is a possibility, but would require further study, further analysis in order to take that a little more seriously, a little more involved. So we're happy to answer questions that you have on the premier.
First one's for me, please. That third option to take down a portion of that building, I mean, at that point, until we open it up, even with a study, until we open it and actually get it opened up, we're not really going to know what we got in there. And it could be what we call in the construction industry considerable extras to continue with that. So in the long run, you could end up with maybe extensively more than the fourth option, am I correct?
Yeah, it's there's a lot of unknowns,
yes,
with option three. The only reason we considered it is we're trying to find a most cost-effective, but it's not the long-term solution to the parking ramp.
So that gets you 10 years, and a brand new ramp would get you out in how many?
40 to 50 years.
You may find that option three turns into option four after you get started.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mr. Henry, you have a question?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like to bring Mr. Smith up to the chair.
Mr. Smith?
Dan Smith?
Well, I think back to when the McCree ramp opened, I'm going to go back to history. It opened on December 15th of 1990. and Ellis Parking Company was hired by the county to manage it. At that time, it housed 67th, 68th District Courts, GCCARD at that time, now GC, I forget their new name, sorry, and the Health Department, as well as the State of Michigan Department of Human Services. The Health Department at that time had the Burton Clinic in the McCree Building, and there was also a health clinic out on Pearson Road at McCree North. When we had the WIC program and all the vaccinations and everything that were going on, Health Department validated parking depending on what you were there for. If you were there for WIC, they validated your parking. If you were there for vaccinations, they validated your parking, etc. The Health Department on a daily basis at that time, from December of 90 until they moved to the Burton Clinic, averaged over 145 customers a day, just for the Health Department. Yes, just spread out over an 8-hour day. But there were 145 individuals who visited the Health Department at that time. When the Burton Health Clinic closed, of course, their numbers dropped significantly. We can't tell you how many are there now because, for the most part, the Health Department does not validate parking for people who go to their business. Since the state moved out, traffic has dropped. I'll admit that. I've shared that with the previous controller many times. It was a big concern, and the ramp is not anywhere near being used at capacity. I do have to point out, though, that knowing the site and having spent time with engineers over the last 28 years looking at that site, I would like to see the plans that show how they're going to put up a 300-car parking ramp plus a 200-car surface lot. The surface lot currently is a 95-space surface lot. If you tear down the south side of the ramp, you're going to have a maximum additional to that surface lot of about 40 spaces. So it's only about 135-car surface lot. I don't know how you're going to get 200-car surface lot plus a 300-car ramp on there with the size of that ramp, or with the size of that lot. To me, I don't understand that. I do also have to tell you that going through the report, and I did sit down with Ray from Building and Grounds and the gentleman from CHMP and provide some information on the ramp, but I do need to point out that I find it interesting that some of the information in the report is not exactly correct. And in the report, it states that, and it's on page 2 towards the bottom, it states that the federal jurors park on the street. I can guarantee you federal jurors at the federal court building do not park on the street. Their jury notices that they get when they tell them to come to court specifically tell them to park in McCree Ramp. The federal jurors, during their selection, park in McCree Ramp. In most cases after that, when they are seated, they also park in McCree Ramp. There's been two cases that I know of for a fact that they did not park in the McCree Ramp, but they parked them behind the federal court building because of threats that were being made during those cases. The report also does not mention anything about the 67th District Court jurors. It used to be 67th, 68th. It doesn't talk anything about where those individuals are going to park. It also does not address the current 42 monthly parkers that park in that ramp and where they're going to park. That's revenue for the county. So there are numbers missing from the report. Numbers that were provided to CHMP in my office. I can also tell you, and I'm not sure where they got the numbers, I verified some of my numbers earlier, I'm kind of set back by the projected cost of construction of the 300-car parking deck. They're projecting that parking deck for 300 cars to cost $7 million. That comes out to over $23,333 per parking spot. Current parking costs for a brand new parking deck in the state of Michigan are running between $16,500 and $17,500, and that's if you don't own the property. The county owns the property. So some of the numbers, in my opinion, and based on talking with some people who are in the parking industry and build parking ramps, the numbers are a little inflated. I can also tell you that knowing what is with the parking ramp, that option 3,
The repairs to remaining north parking structure estimated at $870,000 is way, way off. There was a proposal provided to the county about 3.5 years ago. It was provided to the controller. I don't know whatever happened to it. But to do the north side of that ramp and to get 20 to 25 years out of it is going to run about $3 to $3.5 million. I know that for a fact. $830,000 is nowhere near the correct number to renovate the north side of the parking structure, knowing what's wrong with it. But that proposal was not to go in and replace the tendons in the ramp. That proposal was to go in, put the external PT on the beams, and then build a steel superstructure around the rest of the ramp, which would eliminate the need to do any repairs to the post-tension tendons. 20 to 25 years. Is that 50 years? No. But remember, if you build a new parking deck, you're only going to get 50 years out of it if you do proper maintenance. Unfortunately, proper maintenance to parking structures in general is not done. If you do not set aside $250,000 to $300,000 a year and keep banking that, just because you don't use it doesn't mean it goes away. It means you put that in reserve. Then 5 years from now, when you have to go in and do repair work to the ramp, you're not going to have the money to do it. So if you don't do proper maintenance, no matter how big or how small or how great the structure is when you build it, if you don't put the money aside to do the maintenance, it's going to deteriorate.
Isn't that how we got here now?
Sure is. And it started way before the county ever owned it.
If this new ramp was built, you're with the company that does maintenance on it now. And
that's correct.
So you have vested interest in kind of keeping things the way they are then?
Because of the relationship
with the company?
No, sir. I want to see what's best for the county, what's best for the citizens of the county, and what is best going to be also for the other businesses that have expressed interest in using that structure if repair work was done.
But to be honest, you have really no background in construction, and you don't do it. You're not a cement mason by any means. You're not an architect. You're not an engineer, right?
No, I'm not.
But you've been around a few.
I've been around quite a few, sir.
I call for the doctor, but I don't want to be a doctor.
I never say I was an engineer, sir.
You have any other questions?
Yes, I do. Let's ask Mr. Valachek to come up, please. When the, let's say the influx of money that looks like it's coming through the water crisis in the city, and part of that, I don't know if I have it right, Stratford Grant, whatever it is, is that going to increase the flow of residents into the health department? Because it looks like a lot of money for screening, a lot of money for various preventive health.
It makes more people eligible because of the Medicaid expansion that has occurred. And we, probably the bulk of clients that we see in immunizations, for example, and likewise, WIC services, if you're Medicaid eligible, you're pretty much going to be eligible for WIC. So it likely increases the population that's going to be eligible for our services. Yes.
And do you, I'm sure you do, have various times of the year when there's peak use opposed to June?
Absolutely. Back to school, immunizations. Unfortunately, parents wait till the couple weeks before school, and when the schools start excluding the students from the schools, then we get an influx of kids needing their shots. Likewise, flu season is a big concern for us. We're even more concerned, as you probably read, because we're seeing an increase in Shigella cases. Shigella is a fecal oral transmitted disease. We suspect that some of that may have to do with the fact that people in Flint are afraid to use the water to wash their hands. And one of my concerns that I've expressed to the state is that I think we're going to have to do a much bigger job of trying to immunize during flu season, or going to likely have some negative consequences if people aren't properly immunized.
Are our numbers, would you say our numbers are up in the health department for 2015?
Definitely up in WIC and immunizations.
Mr. Chair, I know we have to do something with Grant. I've known it for the 10 years I've been here, and I've got a moment to do something. I think the county needs to evaluate everything that needs to be done and go to the bank once, so we don't put ourselves in a situation where we can't go back to the bank. I'd like to evaluate this building. I'd like to evaluate the McCree building as far as space and how much space is empty, how much space is empty in this building. Really, totally evaluate the Burton Center. I mean, all this should be all evaluated, and it should be all done in one operation, not piecemeal about the way this is proposed. So I can't support it because it just hasn't had the homework done to it.
No, I disagree with that. We've had three studies done on the parking ramp.
I did figure you'd disagree.
May we respond to some of the comments that were made? Basically, I'm going to start with first the construction costs. I disagree with the previous statements on the construction costs. We monitor construction costs daily. In this area, the costs within the last 5 years has extremely escalated. The costs have to also include the demolition, and the demolition of this has to be done in phases. You can't just shut your operations down. That was accounted for in our numbers. So I strongly disagree with the last speaker's statement on construction costs. We took a close look at it, and we feel our numbers are realistic and industry standard. Kevin's got some comments, too, on the parking deck utilization. Anybody that uses that ramp will know how underutilized that facility is right now, how empty it is. I don't care what day you go there. I don't care when you want to look. It's very much underutilized, and our numbers are well-founded based on the information provided by Ellis Parking, provided by the perimeter people that utilize the ramp. We spoke with the federal courts. We spoke with the circuit courts. We got a lot of good information. It's in the report. Our numbers are accurate.
Mr. Chair. Mr. Mason, is it a fact or not a fact? All we've heard is a 50-year ramp. You can build a ramp to exceed 50 years.
Yeah, but typically, if you ask for a life expectancy of a ramp, you're going to hear 50 years. The reality is, if it's well-maintained, it will last much longer than 50 years.
The Detroit Metro parking ramp, the new one, is designed for 100-year life. So it depends what product you end up buying trying to try to make. And that needs to be looked at as well. We never thought we'd see 50 years on that ramp. And how many years is it?
It should be
50 years.
We should have.
Well, it exceeded 50 years in the poor maintenance it had. So, I mean, there's... Once again, there's lots of things to look at long before we make a decision.
So we do the studies, and then we pay no attention to them.
Not very thorough.
And then we keep on, and we just keep on keeping on, and do no maintenance, not set any money aside for the maintenance.
And we did do maintenance.
Well, not enough to really get you through.
You never do, but they exceeded the 50 years, didn't they?
Anything else? Please, carry on.
Just wanted to touch back on our projected parking usage. We came up with 340 spaces a day, and again, it specifically includes a peaking factor for jury assembly, and we're proposing in the neighborhood of a 500 space capacity when all things are done. Will it be 300 parking and ramp and 200 on the surface? Well, obviously that's to be determined, but 500 parking spaces seems feasible on that site. The ramp is going to be smaller than the 493 rectangle that's on there now. Obviously, that gives you more surface area for exterior parking. We spoke directly with GSA, and they told us that the McCree structure is typically not used for their jury assembly, and they only have one or two trials a year. So the federal courthouse does not seem to be utilized, parking for the federal courthouse doesn't seem to be utilized. I came directly from GSA, so Daniel may disagree, but we reached out to the appropriate contacts, so we felt that our work has been diligent in our research.
Commissioner Adams?
I think that it's good that we do have this information. It's a starting place for sure, and I don't think it's being ignored. That's important to take a look at this and ask the questions. With regard to option four, it doesn't really specify, but it was kind of implied by your comments. Would this involve a new pedestrian ramp between the parking ramp and the buildings?
Yeah, that would be the purpose. We would build it high enough to meet that access point.
And we would be replacing the bridge. The bridge has questions structurally as well, the pedestrian bridge that needs to be addressed.
Right, that was what I was referring to.
That's part of the cost as well.
But in the interim, if you demolish the whole thing, then you have to seal that off with a period of time where you're redoing it.
It would be a phasing process which we'd have to implement with any construction project to allow continued use so that we recognize that.
There isn't a time in here, unless I missed it. Was there a time in here someplace and I just skipped over that? There was no kind of estimated timeline, so there's no way really to know.
We were contracted to evaluate what should be done with the ramp, what are your options. We didn't get into the details of construction documents or time frames. We just put together some budget numbers and some options for you to consider.
Okay. With regard to the access through the pedestrian walkway, whoever tentatives, that is important in terms of access by any disabled person. If you take that away, it makes it very, very difficult to have unimpeded access. So I would think whoever the tenant might be who takes up that space, but since MSUE is going to be looking for a place to go, if we pull the occupants of the Harrison Street building into the G-Card building on Saginaw, MSUE will be a place to go. I don't know if anybody's approached them, but that's just an example. There are possible other tenants, but whether it's someone on a jury or another tenant or somebody going to the health department, I think that that barrier-free access is a factor. One thing that I became aware of, an employee texted me regarding use, and she said that in her department alone, about 100 visitors per day. So clearly it is kind of an excess of what you were looking at, because that's only one of the departments over there. So there's that. She says someone had estimated there was an average of 50 visitors per day in Berkeley Clinic. She says that's completely off. It's in a way that is accurate. So
you need to keep account that when they visit, they're only there for an hour to 2 hours, and then somebody else comes. There's a rotation that occurs with these usage of these parking facilities.
Right, but when you're saying 50 per day, that means 50 people going in and out per day, right? And she said there's no way that's accurate, because she knows it's well over 100, so.
You used the 50 as a peak number.
So I was, the reason I'm saying that is, now in terms of your traffic at Burton, I'm assuming that you looked at that, and I was wondering, how did you get to that? Because if they're seeing over 100 in a given department, I am just baffled. I mean, you're saying that you averaged out, maybe there were some days there were a whole lot less. Over what period of time would that have been? Because clearly the number just doesn't represent the reality.
Once again, we used peak numbers. There's a rotation that happens at the clinics where visitors come in. There's only X number of exam rooms, X number of waiting seats. There's a rotation that occurs. So what we focused on would be peak activity and a 2-hour rotation, basically.
Yeah, okay. Well, apparently, that's not reality. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have some notes that I took concerning two things, the ramp particularly, and then the impact that this will have with Burton Center. So let me just deal with the ramp. What time of day did you estimate? What time of day does the ramp get the most usage? And I just heard you say the average person spends about 2 hours.
That's what we estimated. We took our total count of visitor parking at 170, and we divided that across the period from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., estimated a two-hour stay, and then added 50% on top of that. So it's not, we didn't pick a certain two-hour period. We spread the visits across 9 to 4, said that the car would be, the vehicle would be there for 2 hours, and then what that number would be, and then we added 50% to that.
Of that, those visitors, are they getting passes, or are they paying cash for their parking usage?
I'm not certain. I believe Daniel Smith could speak closer to that as far as the number that are
if they're valid,
paid or validated.
We didn't do a revenue count. We just did a people count in terms of that.
Mr. Valachek, did you leave?
We're estimating 90 paid and 80 validated.
Can you, do you have any knowledge of, within the health department, who validates or if there are any validations?
Because of budget cuts that we've taken over the past 6 years, we discontinued validation.
That's right. I just wanted to be sure. So there are no validations from the health department. What about the courts? Mr. Smith, do you know? Are there any validations from the court?
Validations for the courts depend on how many jurors they have in. I mean, if circuit courts bring 70 jurors in and they all park in McCree Deck rather than having seated jurors park here, we could have 70 circuit court jurors in a day. District court runs between 30 and 40 when they have a jury comes in, which is about every 2 to 3 weeks. So, and they're there at least one day, 3 to 4 hours. Sometimes they come back a second day. If they come back a second day and it's just a seated juror for district court, it's only 7 or 8 people.
Okay. And it could be costly for some people. Mr. Smith, can you tell me, in this whole scheme of things, what do you see as being, right now, a barrier to this, to us being moving forward on this? Or do you perceive a barrier? Why should we not do it? I'm moving to the money factor, but do you perceive any real barrier?
I'm not going to say that the county shouldn't look at building a new ramp. And I'm not going to stand here and say that the county should just renovate the current ramp. During the whole process, there will be an inconvenience to whether you tear it down, build new, whether you do it in the phase structure, which had been discussed with the county about 5-6 years ago. The biggest barrier is going to be the length of time that you lose the access from the ramp into the building on the second level, forcing individuals to go around the outside. That would be the biggest barrier, is losing that access for those who park in the ramp to have easy access to the ramp.
So that's visitors and employees. Lastly, several of you used the term maintenance of the ramp. What does maintenance entail? Is it a regular system?
The maintenance I'm talking about, you have a couple of different types of parking structures. You have precast, where they cast the stuff off-site, bring it in on a truck, and then use a crane to build it. You then have the post-tension parking deck, which is what we have, where they build it on-site, and it's held together with tendons. I'd like to go, and I know that this is a very poor way of describing it, but as a little kid, you take an old shoebox, you put toothpicks in the end of it, and you stretch rubber bands to see how tight you could get them.
basically, that's what a post-tension parking ramp does, is they built the columns, they put the, what steel superstructure there is in, they put the beams in, and then they run tendons every 18 to 22 inches apart, up to 200 feet long. Once they're in, they pour the concrete, and then they tension these tendons. And that's what gives the structure its ability to hold vehicles. And parking ramps are built to a much less pound per square foot than what a building is, the person is in. And, but that's what it is, it's a box with rubber bands stretched as tight as you can on them.
So that's called maintenance dam.
So what you do is, every 3 to 5 years, you have a firm come in, they go through, they do a study, they do test sites to find out if any of the tendons are broken, and then they do the maintenance. That would be the maintenance I'm talking about.
Okay, okay, that's what you get to that. Now I understand.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. And my last question, Mr. Chair, to the gentleman. You mentioned that at this time, there's high construction cost. Is this in our area or period?
In Michigan in general, there's a shortage of labor because of the increase in construction. Back when the recession hit, a lot of the trades left the state, and what we're finding is a lack of labor. So even if you can get an electrician or get a mechanical contractor, you're paying a premium for it now because they have a lot of work. So though our numbers are reflective of what we're seeing in the industry right now. And in terms of the maintenance, I just wanted to add too that typically, if there was a report done, an in-depth report on the existing ramp in 2010, and they recommended some pretty severe repairs, significant repairs. Maintenance usually on a ramp includes your sealing it, your patching cracks, your painting, we've got some serious deterioration in the stairways, the elevators are in bad shape. They all require ongoing repairs and maintenance as part of that whole effort. That's an ongoing thing that needs to occur with the facility, any facility that you have, the ongoing maintenance. And since 2010, there really hasn't been a significant amount of maintenance done on that ramp or repairs for that matter.
Thank you so much. Lastly, Mr. Chair, on our Burton issue, I am not comfortable at this point from the information I've heard that a transition is going to be even near smooth. I recall when we did the transition with the Pearson Road, a lot of people, I always see moms with these kids who don't, everyone in Michigan, everyone in Flint does not have a car. And it becomes really a terrible, takes toll on the families. I have not heard yet how the health department can easily make this transition so that the moms with immunizations, the moms with the use of WIC, and everything else can make this transition smooth. It may be there, I just haven't heard it.
I believe that's right, it's gonna be there. There's more people to present today. And I think you'll find that WIC down there is the Bird Center. It's not going to be dissolved, there'll still be a presence of WIC, so there would be two places to go back WIC now.
And we've gotta keep that in mind.
Yeah, that's a fact. But that presentation is, we've been stuck in a parking ramp here. So
I would like to move on to that.
There's been two questions on this portion so far. Commissioner?
My whole thing with each one of the options is, and I know we definitely need to do something related to that parking ramp, but how are we going to pay for it? Nobody's talking about that. Each one of the steps that we have to go through, where are we going to get the financing to be able to do it? If we do a study and we, if we decided to demolish the whole thing and build it, where's the money going to come from? Because I hear all the rhetoric back and forth, but nobody's talking about the finance. That's the key. How are we going to pay for it?
Could you bring the controller? Let's go on with the presentation.
Okay, our next presentation is on the actual relocation of the Burton Clinic. The next presentation is the relocation of the Burton Clinic. Just to kind of explain what the second part of our efforts involved is to program the needs working with, closely with the Burton Health Clinic staff to relocate those departments. And actually, we expanded some of those departments slightly to meet some of their ongoing growth needs, to relocate that department into the vacated space in the McCree building to consolidate those services within the health department's main administrative building and offices on the second floor of the McCree building. And so this plan that I have up in front of you reflects that. Essentially, we're looking at the color-coded areas, which include WIC, women, infant, and children. That would be the blue shaded areas. Bear with me here.
Your copy said we could see, because I can't see that.
Can you see me? You said shift. All right, can you zoom into that?
That's a little bit. Thank you.
Okay, there we go. Center that up. Okay, so the blue area represents, again, everything that's located north of the main corridor. Pointer. Pointer won't help you. You're looking on the side. Everything north of the main corridor is vacant right now. So one of the questions that was raised was, well, how do we do this and keep them up and operating? Well, it's fairly simple. The construction would occur in the vacated space before they would transition from the clinic into the new space. If we were able to do that, there would be no downtime, just maybe a weekend or to transition and move and get acquainted to the new space. So the blue area represented the women, infant, and children. That's 10,561 square feet. The brown shaded area that is just adjacent to the women, infant, and children, that was immunization. That would be the immunization department. That's 4,218 square feet. And then below that, the light green area, we would be relocating communicable diseases from the south side of the corridor to the north side, along with hearing and vision and children health services. Those are the three small areas located towards the bottom of the plan on the vacant space. The plan also includes renovation to the adult clinic, expanding the adult clinic, which is on the lower right side of the plan, and then developing bigger, larger plans for wellness program. That would be the pink shaded area. The plan also calls for a new pharmacy. That's the orange area in the middle of the plan. And then a small renovation area for immunization registry located on the far southeast corner of the existing plan. The rest of the spaces would remain. So we have a total of about 32,000 square feet of renovated areas. Proposed for relocating the Burton Clinic and some upgrades to the health department. And again, the plan has been reviewed a number of times by staff. We respond to all input received. So we feel we have a pretty good representation of meeting all their needs.
Commissioner Adams.
Mr. Chair, for some reason that drawing is in my packet, nor is the cost estimate. I kind of see that, but what would be the cost estimate?
We're still finalizing the cost estimate. We're looking at roughly budget numbers about $55 a square foot for renovated area. So if you take the total amount of area, it's going to be somewhere between $1.5 and $1.8 million to renovate. It was the estimate is in process. We have not finalized it. A budget number that we usually use for renovated area is around $55 a square foot. Using that number as a budget, it's between 1.5 and 1.8, but we're still finalizing the estimates.
Chair, Mr. Mason, what's the estimated time?
we would anticipate to do the renovations probably 5 to 6 months.
There's no electrical has to be moved or any HVAC?
The HVAC system's in place. It's modifying. It's a VAV type system. So it's just a matter of moving diffusers, moving controls. It's fairly simple in terms of the mechanical. There is some plumbing that would need to be done. We have to add some toilets and some sinks for the clinical activities, which involves getting below to the spaces below. So some of that work would have to be done after hours because it's in the court space.
What fire suppression?
Fire suppression's in place. Again, these are adjustments to the existing heads. The system's already in place.
How long do you anticipate the ramp? If we did over 4, how long would that take?
The ramp would probably, again, it would have to be done in a phased effort. So I would anticipate the ramp to be closer to a year construction.
To demo and replace?
We didn't get that detailed, but I was examining taking down the what would be the north end of the ramp, leaving the south end for the construction of the new, so you'd have some parking logistically. It would be ideal to do it in two phases so they could keep some of the existing ramp in place so you're not out all of your parking. Those details have not been worked out.
How long would the crossover be shut down?
We would probably phase that so that would be the last thing to be done, so we minimize the downtime. But I would anticipate if materials were ordered, that work could be done in probably about one month, probably 4 weeks if timing was done well. So you'd have about a 4 week period where visitors would have to be entered from the Saginaw Street entrance.
But you got to shut down the retrofit, the existing.
If you build the new ramp on the south end of the site and keep the old and then take it down in two pieces, logistically you might be able to. Remember, we're only replacing about half the size of the ramp. So theoretically, you could build a ramp on the south side, keep the north end up, take it down after the south end is built. I mean, there's some phasing that could be done if it was well planned out to keep you in operation.
Thank you. I need to ask Mr. Belichick a couple questions, if I could, please. Mark, I know various grants require different mandated requirements to facilitate the grant. It might be confidentiality, it might be distance from another service, or whatever it is. Do you have anything to dwell on that?
The WIC program is a federal program, and it has specific requirements that the clients cannot incur a cost in obtaining the service. So if there were a parking fee, just as when WIC was downtown, we had to reimburse that fee using county dollars.
On the health side of it, though, are there certain, like the sexually transmitted diseases has to be separate from something else? Or that type of thing is what I'm really asking. But, did the floor plan that was submitted approve that, or did you have any input?
We were involved with the architectural firm in the design on that, and yes, we did have input in that, myself and my staff.
Good. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
The other questions? Do you have anything else, Greg? Any other questions for this presentation? Hearing none, let's move to Greg Realty, please. Thank you, Greg.
Chairman Jim McGurk Realty Company, and I also have with me Clarence Pierce, the Chief Executive Operation Officer at Hamilton Clinic. I'd like to suggest that Mr. Pierce be given a moment to explain what Hamilton Clinic does in Burton and what they would do if they were to be able to acquire the new building. And I'll speak to the real estate information following that, if that's right. move out and build a new facility. And in building that facility, no one could have predicted the kind of capacity that would have been generated when we moved. And what happened was, from the day we opened the doors, we were at capacity. And we have been struggling with trying to deal with that capacity since we've been there, since 2010. At this point, we have increased our hours of operation. We are now open 12 hours a day to try to deal with the capacity. We have a variety of different services, from medical, we're talking pediatrics, internal medicine, family medicine. We have behavioral health services. We provide dental services. And what we want to do is add some additional services to address the needs of the community. We're not looking at reducing services. We want to increase services so that we can address some of the other needs in the community. And what we have offered is, in terms of WIC services, we would provide that space to the health department at no charge. Because what we would want to do is create a women and children's center in that facility with some specialty services in partnership with the University of Michigan. We have a great relationship with the University of Michigan, and we're providing some specialty services now at our main facility at 2900 North Saginaw Street. That's a 31,000 square foot facility. If we had known that we were going to have the kind of capacity we have at Burton, we would have built a facility equally as big. But we were dealing with space constraints, and unfortunately, there's not enough property where we're located to expand. We're really kind of crunched in between the health department and McDonald's with the, I believe it's the rear of our facility has some property back there. But it is GM property, and it is contaminated, and we can't really do anything with that. Otherwise, we would be looking at some kind of renovation or some kind of added space build out. So we believe that by adding the Women and Children's Center, that would allow now us to provide more services to the community for those who cannot travel outside of the area or may have difficulty traveling outside of the area. Specialty services in particular requires people to travel either to Ann Arbor, Detroit, or Lansing, or somewhere outside of our location. And I know that a lot of our patients have difficulty getting to those other areas. I think, ideally located in terms of public transportation. We know that many of our patients do not have cars, and they rely on public transportation. Our facility is probably no more than 50 yards from the bus stop. And what we try to do, and the reason we try to provide a comprehensive program, is because in many cases, when people get out in the wintertime, particularly mothers with two or three children, no transportation, they can at least get the bus, they can come to one of our sites. We can provide all of the services they need for mom, for the children, and they can get their medications because we have a pharmacy in our Burton site on the way out. And so it is a comprehensive program, and we want to make it more comprehensive. So that we can now deal with the issues of the children and the women in one facility. And it would be much more convenient, it would be much more efficient for us, and it would give us some additional space to open up so we can deal with more capacity for the adults at our current location. So that's what we're trying to do here in terms of trying to address our capacity issues and work with the health department. We're not here to try to compete. We want to work with them, and if we can do WIC services there, it will allow the citizenry who lives live in the Burton community. If they choose to stay in the Burton area, they want to access services at the current location, we would like to have that available for them. And so the idea is for us to continue providing these most needed services that we have now, adding these additional services and working in collaboration with the health department so that we can do a better job for the people in the Burton community. Thank you.
Any questions? What's your question?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As I listened to your presentation, Mr. Pierce, it seems like there's been many issues well thought out. But again, my concern is that you did address it. My concern is that the moms and children are afforded as less stress as possible, especially as we enter the 1-2 months, and that their services are indeed provided. You know, you can get accustomed to going one place, and that allows you to iron out the wrinkles of getting to that one place. You change and add something else to the pie, and there becomes frustrations that, given what's happening in our community now, we don't need to add on any other frustrations. And that leads me to are you going to provide any services addressing the water crisis? Are your plans to deal at all with that?
Absolutely. We're doing that now, Commissioner Glass. We, in fact, had a visit from the Secretary of Health, Secretary Burwell, back in, I believe it was March, and received a $250,000 grant specifically for lead testing in children. We've been doing that now for since really the emergency order came down from the president. And we're actively trying to test, trying to educate, counsel all of those families who need those services. We have made a significant dent into the people who need the testing. Not to say that we still have a lot of work to do, in that when the waiver came down from CMS to extend the Medicaid benefits to the Medicaid population, which allowed them to add some targeted case management services, such as nutritional health, behavioral health for children, and some additional funding to help them with that. What we're finding is many of the Medicaid recipients don't really understand that this is an added benefit that they can access. So our big challenge now is trying to educate them, trying to get the word out to them that you have this benefit and that you need to use it. Because most people think, if I have Medicaid, well, I really don't need to do anything else. Although this is an extension on to the current Medicaid benefit. So no, we would not in any way withdraw the kind of intensity that we have now with regard to testing children. And we're finding even a lot of the adults are coming in asking to be tested because many of them have been impacted as well. There's just no benefit for them at this point that we can actually access. But we are trying to expand our testing, ability to educate. We're doing sessions. We had a session at Burton. We had a great turnout. Many people came out to get some education about it. We have our outreach and enrollment specialists out calling people, making visits, getting people signed up. So we're very active in trying to get ahead of this and working with people in the community to address those needs.
I just wonder, Mr. Pierce, why Burton City Council did not know. I think I heard Ms. Ellenberg say that they had no knowledge of this potential transferring of that building. And I would think they would have been an excellent instrument to begin to get the word out. I have to feel, if you were to respond to this, Mr. Pierce, this transition will not affect the people who use the Burton Center in any other way if there, if this were to occur. If you don't respond to that, that it will not affect them in any other way because, what would you say? Or can you say that?
Well, I can. I can say that I don't think it would affect them in any way, Commissioner Klein, in that we would be substituting the WIC services. Currently, the health department provides the WIC and the immunization. We provide immunizations, have been since, you know, we started. The only thing we don't provide are WIC services. And so we have offered that we would work with them to continue the WIC services at no charge to the county. And I think that's a pretty good offer for the sole reason of making sure that the people in Burton don't feel any impact in this transition.
What about the employees?
Employees now, I mean, whatever employees they
won't
have.
Won't have anything to do with the health?
Yes, I mean, we would keep whatever employees they have that deal with the WIC services at Burton. I don't know what it would mean in terms of transitioning some of that staff to downtown, but you know, we would be happy to work with Mark and his staff.
Have you had that conversation concerning the employees?
We have had just a brief conversation. We didn't get into any detail.
Thank you so much, thank you, Mr. Pierce. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair, I want to commend you, of course, for things that you've done for the community. But of course, it is distinct from the health department and health department programs. I can appreciate what you're saying about the county would pay to retain space for the WIC. Of course, you couldn't just take that program over. That's a government program that needs to continue to supervise. What if, and I think the idea about the women's program would be a nice thing. What if, maybe after further evaluation, the health department were to find, okay, this particular portion should be taken downtown. If that were the case, and if there was space available, could you possibly rent space from the health department?
Well, we have kind of a plan and a strategy whereby we would do it all of the, if we're talking women's health, we'd like to integrate the women's health with the children's health. Because in most cases, if mom needs help, 9 times out of 10, she's taking her child or her children. And so they tend to go to one location. If we just, you know, cut one off, well, we still have the situation where you're going to two locations to access the services. What we're trying to do is make it such that it's comprehensive enough that you can see everything under one roof. You don't have to go places.
Well, of course, that's what we have right now at the health department for our purposes, but thank you. You know, I'm looking at these figures. It cost $1.5 million, $1.8 million to renovate space and create. That's not even looking at the ramp figures, 5 to 6 months to do that. So I see no way that can happen because it looks like the offer is only $1.5 million. So we would take a 0.5 or 0.8 million loss. Just in numbers, that doesn't make sense. And since it's like a 90-day transition, that would take at least 5 or 6 months to do the renovation, and then work for a year on the ramp. So time-wise, that simply doesn't work. Did you have anything you wanted to respond to?
Well, I mean, we're not under any significant time constraints. Whatever time it takes you, we're prepared to work with you.
You know, maybe after, appropriate fact-finding is done, there might be a road to something that would work for you, but I guess I can't see how that could happen anytime real soon. But thank you.
Mr. Henry.
Chair, Mr. Pierce.
Yes, sir.
How many counselors would you anticipate, if you took over the WIC program, how many counselors would you provide for that service?
Counselors?
Yes.
Now you're talking about family planning, I assume.
I assume, yeah.
Well, currently we do not do family planning. We work with the health department on that, and we tend to refer people to them for that. It's something we could do, but again, we would want to work with them wherever we can so that we're not duplicating anything. We don't want to duplicate services. I mean, our position is we would like any resources that we can have come into the community to provide a better service and to stretch the resources that we have. We're all for that. We support that 100%.
I ask Mr. Malachek a question, please. Mark, my understanding is we have like 5 or 6 counselors. They handle what, 25 to 40 people a day?
For the WIC program?
Yes.
Well, there are nutritionists who do the counseling. There are health techs who do, we have to do the metric measures. We have to do a blood hematocrit to measure the iron. We got special permission from the feds to also now do lead testing in the WIC clinic. So they're also doing lead testing for those kids and offering that to pregnant moms.
That's the grants we received from that, the county.
Correct.
There's no match required, is there?
That's correct.
Funding. So I would assume you would receive that funding. So really, no cost to the county. I don't understand that.
No, we don't receive any funding from the county.
If you did the service, you receive the funding or not? Confused here.
Well, we received our funding from the feds, HHS. And I think, Mark, you get separate funding for the things that you do, which makes a pretty good relationship in that we have a different stream of funding than he does, so his funding would continue, and so would ours.
You don't see the client's funding then? It's based on clients, correct?
Correct. We're paid in the WIC program based upon the caseload that we see.
So if we didn't do the service, we wouldn't bring that money into all the...
Excuse me. The county would still be doing the WIC program just at Burton Center, correct?
That's my understanding.
So he's just going to offer space at that point for us to have a presence for WIC there?
That's my understanding of
So it would be the same, just we'd have a free space there. County would still be running. No change in clientele. Just two places to go instead of one.
Kind of inconvenient.
It's not an inconvenience. If you got an extra space, an extra area, so you ain't got to all go to one spot. If you got, and by the way, a majority of the WIC, I believe, are zip codes of the Flint area. Am I right?
Correct.
So, majority of them are already here in Flint and have to travel out there to get to it, even though there's a bus station. But now we would have two spots, correct? So the people in Burton are not losing any services. We're not losing any services.
You sound like a troubled and bitter person.
I'm not a troubled, bitter person, brother. I just wonder why you're trying to muddle that up.
It is muddled.
No, it's not.
The process has been muddled.
I'm sorry you can't figure it out. Sorry. Let's move on. We have Mr. McGurk come on.
Thanks. Jim McGurk Realty, to describe information related to the real estate transaction should you decide to move forward. The original concept here was to consolidate spaces and bring some operational cost savings to the table. The health department transition and the parking deck and all those things obviously are added variables to this particular transaction. To the deal specific, the Hamilton Clinic and the county jointly participated in the cost of an appraisal that was done back in December 2015. That appraisal came in at $1,050,000. The agreement allows for the county to have up to approximately 6 months of transition time period, contingent contingency for construction costs that CHMP has already begun space planning and that type of thing. And then once the transaction's closed, still another 60 or 90 or 120 days to move. So there is a time period in the agreement of up to 6 months for that transaction. With regards to the operational costs, Ray has estimated ballpark numbers that the county could save as much as $150,000 a year to not having to spend those dollars at the Burton Clinic for dollars that they're already spending to maintain the Courts and Human Services Center space. Also, the plan from CHMP actually allows the Health Department to double in size and continue to handle some of their growth. They're in about 16,000 square feet right now. This would allow them to go up to about 32,000 square feet. So the basics as far as the real estate goes would be $1,050,000. Some operational costs of $150,000 to possibly offset the difference between building the space out and the sale proceeds, and the time period of approximately 6 months. The purchase agreement, the actual purchase agreement, was submitted about 60 days ago. I believe everyone did get a copy, and I think copies of the appraisals were submitted months ago as well. Questions?
Commissioner Henry.
The chair. Mr. McGurk, was there any real estate sign posted on that site for sale?
No, it was not actively marketed to third parties. The Hamilton Clinic expressed an interest in the facility, and there was a MAI appraisal, and the county picked the appraiser.
So pretty much no transparency to it. John Doe couldn't have the right to purchase it because he didn't know about it.
Well, that's not to say that he'd pay over appraised value either.
Well, they could have if they had the need for it. We all know that.
Possibly.
Location, location, location. Secondly, what is your commission on this piece?
My contractual agreement with the county is anything that is sold, there's a 3% commission. And if it's not sold, there's no charge for my time and energy.
Are there any other costs affiliated with it?
The to the transaction, your standard seller's title insurance costs, and there was also consideration of approximately $29,000 of an offset to the purchaser for some deferred maintenance. Historically, there's been a little bit of a roof issue with that skylight and some miscellaneous things that if the county were to stay there, they'd have to do themselves. And so part of the negotiations was $29,000 going back to the purchaser.
I guess my biggest beef is it wasn't really openly marketed. If you weren't on the inside scoop, you didn't get a chance to buy it.
I understand what you're saying, Commissioner Henry, but at the same time, we obtained an MAI appraisal, which gives you a fair market value of the value of the property at that time. I don't know how you could do any better.
You and I both know how you can do better, Jim. You do it every day. Thank you.
I'd like to say that I thought that part of this Burton Center, this area, that we didn't want to put it in the open market, really. I mean, so much we got the appraisal so we know where the fair market value was. Because of the services that the health center offers, we kind of wanted to keep those services rather than move a Walmart in there. That's what I understood. So it's better for the county and the people in the county.
There were those intangibles, and as Mr. Pierce has presented, there would be continued services to the community for what's being provided there. Everything from the beginning was not just a cost analysis. There were commissioners that expressed interest in continuing to provide programs to the community in that area.
Okay. Any other commissioner questions? Okay, thank you. There's no old business, new business. A, building and grounds request approval for option 4 of the
CHMP Inc., McCree Parking Ramp Structure Study and Evaluation Attached.
Support.
Okay, have a motion?
Couldn't hear that.
Want me to read it again?
I didn't hear this.
I heard support, do I have?
You moved it, I support.
I moved it, support.
Who moved it?
Me.
You moved it from the chair?
Yeah.
Is supported by who?
Members.
The trouble in the dinner people, okay.
I appreciate you telling me who I am, I appreciate that.
You bet. Anytime.
Usually comes from the same.
Anytime.
Mr. Young.
Yeah, I wanted to offer an alternative motion to look at option three and have the study done as far as the options of tearing down part of the ramp. And that was one of the things that I was pushing for before when we pushed this motion through the first time. So I offered that alternative motion.
Mr. Evans. First of all, are you supporting?
I'm considering supporting what you, I want to be clear, you're asking for further study on.
No, studies, I'm asking that you utilize option four.
Well, I mean, I was asking him about his alternative motion.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. I thought you were asking me, I'm sorry.
No, I was asking about the alternative motion, so what you're saying is you wanted to take a closer look at that option before going forward? That was what you were advocating for the study? Is that what I heard?
What I specifically said was option number three, which includes the study to look at the viability of utilizing part of the ramp versus tearing down the whole ramp.
Okay, so.
Which means we will have to do an engineering study on that,
right,
which is what I requested originally.
Okay. So you weren't saying committing to it necessarily, but looking at it more closely to see if that's really viable.
I think I'm committing, my motion commits to option three as far as to do the study to look at the viability of that as the as an option.
Okay, I'll support.
Did you make a motion to amend the previous motion that was made and seconded?
I offered an alternate motion if that's not proper in accordance with Robert's Rules of Order. I'll amend it.
Okay, you didn't make the motion. Yeah. So I understand the motion is to select option four, and you want to make a motion to look further into option three?
Correct.
We have to vote on the first motion.
I believe you've got to vote on the first motion.
Yes.
On the first motion?
Call a question on number.
On the first motion?
Yes.
Right. Call a question.
But if you knew, if you were going to go ahead with that, I did want to mention, I'm looking at option four as being a good thing, but I just think we need to look more closely. I think this is the first step. We need more.
We got this doesn't make it happen, right? We got to vote this at the full board next week, right? At that time, this can all change, right?
Yeah.
So we can move this forward, and you got a week. You got another week after months of what we've been doing. Actually, years of what we've been doing with that ramp to make this happen. Or at that time,
is the amendment in place?
There's no amendment. You can't make an amendment on a motion we didn't make. It was motion and support.
Point clear. So we're voting on
option A.
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 Only A.
For this particular committee. And then next week, of course, transparency goes into full board.
But will he be allowed, Mr. Chair, to make his motion?
If this motion doesn't pass.
Only it. Okay.
My only concern with this whole thing is nobody's talked about it. How are we going to pay for any one of these options?
Absolutely.
Nobody's answered that.
Well, the question hasn't been answered, but I'll try to answer.
It's ironic you didn't get it.
You're going to save, hold up. You're going to save $200,000 by not having Ellis, who parking, manage the parking structure, who gets upwards between $150,000 and $200,000 now. That's why he had such grave concern in any proposal that's been presented here today. But
Plus, you have excess parking that's open to the public that'll bring revenue in. But no matter how you shake it, no matter how you do it, you can do nothing and then have it come down and be condemned, or you're going to have to bond out. But the key to the bonding out is to have enough revenue to support the bond payment. And you say $200,000 in revenue from Dallas Parking, $150,000, $200,000. You pick up the $150,000 that's projected to save in the Burton building. So there, you either have $300,000 or you have, $450,000 that you could dedicate without any parking revenue coming in, going to the bond. So all the numbers work as far as bonding out for 40 years at the current rates. The bond rating for the county is in good position today. The $57 million for the water treatment plant came in at 3.4, unheard of. And so that scenario is a good place for the county to be right now. So it's almost revenue neutral. There's no better time financially for the county to go forward with this parking structure and have dedicated revenue other than the general fund, which is there, sitting there now. Because the Ellis Parking would come back and could be offset to this. Savings from the Burton building could come back and offset this, as well as proceeds going forward. There won't be an Ellis Parking. There'll be an automatic pay system going in and out, just like they are in all other parking structures across the state of Michigan. Cost savings there, so that money collected will go right toward paying back the bond and any type of maintenance program set aside. So,
thank you. I think we've got two questions answered. It's on the board. It's time to vote. You called the question. Call the question. All in favor, signify by aye.
Aye.
All against? Nay.
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 Do a roll call, please.
Do a roll call, please.
Nolan.
No.
Platt.
No.
Curtis.
Yes.
Young.
No.
Brown.
Yes.
Lynch.
Yes.
Henry.
No.
Adams.
No.
3 yes, 5 no.
Motion fails. Now we got an alternative motion.
If he wants to make. If you
want. So much I make.
And I support.
We got a motion and support. Roll call, please.
Can I have discussion on the motion?
Sure we can.
This still doesn't look at all the capital improvements we need to make. Look at GDRC. That's been as bad as long as this has been bad. I still say slow down, let's look at all our capital improvements we need to make, and let's move forward with one bonding and get it all done. So I can't support it.
Commissioner.
In response to Commissioner Henry, I agree. We need to take a really good look at all of our infrastructure. We need to have a capital plan going forward. Regarding what Commissioner Nolan had to say, we do have to know about the money. And clearly, there would be no savings realized from Burton. I did some rough calculations. It would take us 5 years just to break even on that move, not to mention all of the difficulties that would cause, so that's not going to help with funding. We need to really take a look at funding and all that. But the reason why I support Commissioner Young's motion is because that allows us time for study on that particular option and see if that's viable. I would assert that also gives us time to look at looking at the different providers of ramps and costs and values. That gives us some additional time to look at making sure we get select the best options, making sure we have a good plan going forward. So even though your concerns are very valid, as are Commissioner Nolan's, but I think this might be a way for us to start moving forward, because we have some preliminary work we need to to look at that a little more closely. So for that reason, I will support.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Platt.
Yes.
Curtis.
No.
Young.
Yes.
Brown.
No.
Lynch.
Nope.
Henry.
Yes.
Adams.
Yes.
Nolan.
Yes.
Henry.
No.
Four, four.
Yes.
B. Request to rescind Resolution 16352, Genesee County Real Estate Policy, or waive said policy as to pending purchase offer for Burton Health Clinic.
Support the waiver.
Mr. Chair, consideration for B and C. A request to table both of these, B and C, until our next meeting. There's still information that I think I'm not the only one who would be comfortable in knowing. We had some discussion, but I think we, at this point, had a lot of information to absorb, and I don't feel comfortable making that final decision on this now. We had additional information that I think we need to consider. Anytime lives are a priority, and it is with me, I think we need to take a thorough look again at information that I'm going to request from both entities before I decide I can be comfortable. So I'd like to table B and C because they're related.
I'll support that.
Mr. Chair, I don't believe table is the right word.
It would be a motion to postpone that.
Postpone.
To postpone.
Now, we come back to this committee
rather than postpone. Well, it depends where the motion is. Wants to postpone it to the board, postpone it to the public works.
Postpone it to the board.
In what time? To print?
Our next.
26?
26 is fine with me. Okay. I think I can gather. Yes. Yes, 26 is fine.
And support.
Support. So it's got a motion and support. Any other discussion?
There's no discussion on postponement right here.
Okay, that's correct. That's correct.
That's fine. I know there was not a tabling, but I thought on postponement.
Postponement.
But there's debate. So let's just signal that there is debate on this.
It's debatable.
Debatable. We'll hear it then. Commissioner Adams.
I think that if you look at the figures and you look at the fact that a move from the Burton Clinic to McCree would cost between 1.5 and 1.8 million, it would take 5 years to even break even on that. It would definitely not save us. The operational costs, $150,000 a year, are nothing compared to the loss we would take on that move, not to mention disruptive program. As far as rescinding the resolution, that may pertain to the resolution to make sure that we provide fact-finding and public disclosure on any real estate transaction. That's not just Burton. There are others as well. And I think it is important for us to say no to rescinding that. Because I'll tell you, perhaps you haven't had this experience with your constituents, but any of mine where I brought up this issue, they are shocked that there was even any debate or discussion over that, because they have taken for granted that we would have that ethical structure, then of course we would do fact-finding, and of course we would do public disclosure as a matter of course with regard to any real estate that we own as a county, because that belongs to the taxpayers. So I do not agree with postponing being. I would like to see this board reject rescinding that resolution. In terms of, and of course that puts Hamilton off, or that puts the sale of Burton Health on a hall table for now. But it does not stop the fact-finding, because whether it's the health impacts resolution, which of course isn't even up for debate here, and that alone would stop the sale. Whether it's that,
or the not selling without fact finding and disclosure, you still can go forward with fact finding and disclosure. You can still do that. But in the meanwhile, you do not sell or move toward sale. You just do the fact finding. You do the disclosure. And if you come to a point where those facts and that disclosure show that, yes, this is a good decision, then that's still possible. There's nothing in that resolution that prevents that. Therefore, I cannot support it.
Roll call, please.
This is on B only, correct?
No, this is on table on B and C, right?
No, postpone.
Postpone. Postpone.
Because they're
Curtis.
Yes.
Young.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Lynch.
Yes.
Henry.
No.
Adams.
No.
Nolan.
Yes.
Platt.
Yes.
Passes. No other business? Motion adjourned.
Move it.
Move. Forward.